With these preparations, we are ready to prove the Mazur-Ulam theorem. The proof that we are going to give is due to the mathematician U.C. Vassala. The year is 2003, and this is published in the American Mathematics Monthly. As before, let's first talk about the idea of the proof. The main idea is to make use of the reflections in normed spaces. So here's the definition. For a point, Z in E a vector space, the reflection of E about Z is a map psi from E to E, sending x to 2z minus x. You probably have already known this when you learned geometry or linear algebra. And you might know the following properties of reflections. First, if you reflect a point twice about a certain point, you get back that point. So if you apply psi twice to x, you just get x. So psi composed with psi is just the identity on E. And psi inverse is just the psi itself. Second, if you assume that E is further in normed spaces, if we further assume that E is a normed vector space, then psi is easily to be seen to be an isometry. Thirdly, Z is the only fixed point of psi, namely, if x is equal to psi of x, which by definition is 2z minus x, then this happens even only if x is equal to z. So z is the only fixed point of psi. And the fourth property is very geometric. If you reflect a point and you measure the distance from that point to its reflection about a certain point z, then you will get this distance is equal to the twice of the distance from x to the point that you reflected about. So this has a very specific geometric meaning if you draw a picture. So if this is z, this is x, and you reflect x about z, so this is 2z minus x, then this distance is twice of this distance. So that is the properties of reflections. Now let us go back to the idea of the proof. The general idea is to make use of those reflections. More specifically, Recall that by our proposition 3, it suffices to prove that f preserves a middle point of any line segment. Because here we already know that f is an isometry, which is a continuous map, simply from the definition, which easily follows from just the definition of an isometry. By proposition 3, it suffices to prove that for any a, b, in E, f of a plus b divided by 2 is equal to f of a plus f of b divided by 2. The trick is to make both the left-hand side and the right-hand side the fixed point of the same reflection, so that by the property 3 we just discussed, the uniqueness of the fixed point of reflections, we have the left-hand side is equal to the right-hand side. So let me quickly write this down. To realize this idea, we're going to introduce some new notations. Let z be a plus b divided by 2, and z prime be f of a plus f of b divided by 2. And let psi be the reflection of E about Z, and psi prime be the reflection of F about Z prime. To show that f of a plus b divided by 2 is equal to this f of a plus f of b divided by 2, using our notation, it's same as showing that f of z is equal to z prime. And to show this, by our discussion on the left, it suffices to show that f of z is a fixed point of the reflection psi prime. And now, if f of z is a fixed point of the reflection psi prime, and by the definition of psi prime and the property above, this guy, the right hand side, f of a plus f of b divided by 2, is also a fixed point of this reflection. And by our notation, this f of a plus f of b divided by 2 is z prime. So we get two fixed points of the reflection psi prime. And by the property 3 above, they must be equal. So that is precisely what we want to prove. I hope this idea is clear to you. Using math notations, this is really psi prime applied to f of z is equal to f of z. Now, because f is a bijective isometry, you can take the inverse. So this guy is equivalent to F inverse composed with psi prime composed with F applied to Z equal to Z. So this is what we want to prove. Okay, now let us look at this map, a composition of three maps. What do you see from this map? What are your observations? Your first observation might be that since F, by our assumption, is an isometry, and psi prime, because it is a reflection, is also an isometry. So this composition of three things is an isometry. So this guy is an isometry. That's the first observation. The second observation is that this guy swaps A and B. And now let us quickly check this. Notice that F inverse composed with psi prime composed with F applied to A is equal to F inverse applied to 2z prime minus F of A. And this is equal to F inverse applied to F of A plus F of B minus F of A. This is simply due to the definition of our notations. And this is equal to F inverse applied to F of B, which is simply B. So this map will send A to B. And symmetrically, if you apply this guy to B, you will get A. No more calculations are needed. So we have verified that this map swaps A and B. Okay, now at this point, why not make our life slightly easier? If we are not looking at this composition, but instead looking at this composition, psi composed with F inverse composed with psi prime composed with F, we look at the composition of those four maps. This map will send A to A and B to B. Namely, this point will fix the endpoints of the line segment from A to B. Recall that psi is a reflection of E about Z, and Z is the middle point. So psi itself will swap A and B. So I hope this is easy for you to see. So now instead, we are going to look at this composition. And notice that the thing we want to prove, which is equivalent to this, is further equivalent to showing this. This is further equivalent to the composition of those four maps fixes Z. That is because the psi itself already fixes Z. So it doesn't hurt to apply both sides of this equation by side. And now we are looking at the composition of those four maps. Our observation can be changed a little bit. Now we are looking at the composition of four maps. So this guy is again an isometry. And the composition of four maps actually fixes A and B. And now here comes the beautiful thought in mathematics about the abstraction. We know that the composition of those four maps is an isometry that fixes the endpoint of a line segment. And we want to prove that the composition of four maps fixes the middle point. A professional mathematician would think, okay, let's forget about this specific map. Let's just look at any isometry between normal linear spaces that fixes the endpoints of a line segment. For that general map, can we prove that it also fixes the middle point? So let us forget these specific things, as many as possible, and what is left will hopefully capture the essence of the thing we want to study. And what I just talked about is a common motivation for mathematicians to make things more and more abstract.